Infection prevention and control is the science of how to prevent the potential infection and how to prevent them. This is highly important in any healthcare facility, and especially when we deal in the current era of the spread of the COVID-19. So let's start from the scratch. What is the scratch? Let's identify the chain of infection. When you ask someone, what is the chain of infection? The answer should be, there are six elements in place for an infection to happen. Starting by having number one, the agent. Number two, the reservoir that will harbor the agent. Number three, we're gonna have the portal of exit. Then number four will be the mode of transmission. And then number five will be the portal of entry. And finally, the susceptible host. Now let's talk about them in details. When it comes to the agent, we talk about a virus, a bacteria, a fungus, a protozoa, a worm, any causative agent that might be the precipitating factor and the causative of a disease. All right, this is number one. Where that agent live? It live in a reservoir. So what might be the reservoir? Reservoir might be the human, might be the animal. When you talk about the animal, talk about classification like the pet animal, the farm animal, or even the wild animal. And then it might be a rodent, or it might be something like a media, the food, the water, the milk, the soil. So all of these can harbor, can carry out the infectious agent. Okay, so now we finish with the agent and the reservoir. From the reservoir, we need what we call the portal of exit. This is where the agent is going to leave the current reservoir. So if we talk about an infected person, so the agent will leave through any opening. So through the eye, in the discharge from the eye in conjunctivitis, or it might come through the nose in the process of the sneezing, or it might come through the mouth during the coughing or even laughing, or even during the exchange of saliva in the process of the kissing, or it might come from anterior sexual orifices, the penis, or it might come from the posterior, the anus. All right, so this is what we call it, the portal of exit, and never to forget a breach in the skin or a wound, or also from the mother to the fetus through the placenta. Now, we have the agent live in a reservoir, find an opportunity to leave the reservoir through a portal of exit. Then what we need what we call the mode of transmission. So it's important question, what is the mode of transmission? We have different types of mode of transmission, starting by number one, from a person to person. This is where people are exchanging secretion like saliva. So this is during the process of the kissing or during sexual intercourse. So this is a highly potential for something like HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, or during intimate contact between the two person. So when we have, for example, the syphilis, so all of these could be from person to person. All right, then we might have the droplet infection. This is where a large particle that will not be able to travel for a large distance. A particle size is big and heavy and could only maximum to transfer something not more than 2 meters during the process of coughing, sneezing, or even laughing. All right, or we might have away from the droplet infection, we might have what we call the airborne infection. Airborne infection, this is where the particle size is so small and the particle size is light, has the probability to stay in the air for a longer period of time. Both of them, droplet infection and airborne infection, can produce some of the following disease. They can produce, for example, you're gonna find them in the tuberculosis, you're gonna find them surely during like coronavirus, influenza, measles, chickenpox. All of these can be transmitted either as a private infection or as an airborne infection. For some, airborne only for those with low weight particle, and this we're gonna have it mainly with the measles and with chickenpox and with influenza virus. Okay, all right. Now, away from person to person droplet infection and the airborne infection, we might have what we call the fecal oral transmission. Fecal oral transmission is very common with the food handlers. This is where, after they finish their own toilet, they have inappropriate hand hygiene. So the remnant or the infected remnant might be stay under the nail, and this could be transmitted during the food handling. Another way, another mode of transmission could be through the vomits. This is the direct contact. This is what we call it. When some person is infected, then that person will vomit or cough or sneeze, and the causative agent come out and stay on a surface, non-mobile surface, like the doorknob or the keyboard or the border, the bed rail, and then another person come and touch such surfaces. This is what we call it, the vomit mode of transmission. As last one, we might have it in place, a kind of what we call it, the vector transmission. What's vector transmission? Here we're gonna have a vehicle in between. A third agent, a third party that responsible for transmitting the infection from the first party to the second party. So this is very common in diseases like malaria or dengue fever, or like in malaria, we're gonna have the mosquito responsible for transmitting the infection, dengue fever, or even the fleas would be responsible for transmission of the plague from the rats. So this is when we have the vector transmission. Plus, never to forget, there is a mode of transmission that might happen during, as I said, sharp injury, and it would happen through what we call bloodborne infection. So those are the different modes of transmission. So we talked about that. There we have a host, live in a reservoir, find an opportunity to go out from that reservoir, we call it the portal of exit, and then through a mode of transmission to reach to a new susceptible host. How to reach? Through what we call portal of entry. They are similar to the portal of exit, exactly the same. So they might come and get into the new susceptible host through the conjunctiva in the eye, through the mucous membrane of the nose, through the mucous membrane of the mouth, or through the mucus and opening of the penis or the anus, or even through a breach in the skin, or finally from a mother to fetus through the placenta. So this will be the portal of entry. Reaching to the final destination will be a new susceptible host. So how could be this a susceptible plant? It might reach to non-susceptible. So who are the susceptible? Susceptible are extremes of age, babies, children, geriatric population. Okay, first group. What is the second group? Those who are immunocompromised, like those on long-term corticosteroid, those on chemotherapy, those on long-term immunosuppressive agent. So they are immunocompromised, or they live with a debilitating disease, like renal impairment, liver impairment, chronic conditions, uncontrolled chronic conditions. So these are a kind of a chronic debilitating disease. So those will be susceptible. Plus, never to forget those who never received the vaccination before. If we have all of this, so this means that the agent reached to a susceptible host. Here, we can expect the infection to happen. Or even, by the way, anyone, even if that person got the vaccine, but he or she might got the second attack rate. All right, so this is, as we said, the chain of infection. The question for us, you said it's infection prevention and control. So how can we prevent this from happening? So let's go into the chain of infection and try to build barriers against every single component from those six elements. So what can you do with the agent? Simply, you can kill the agent by using the proper antimicrobial medication. So if it is a bacteria, you can use the antibiotic. If it is a virus, you can use the antivirus. If it is a fungus, you can use the antifungal medication, protozoa, antiprotozoa medication. Number one, so medication in place, antimicrobial medication will work. Number two, the proper, if it lives on a surface, so the proper disinfection of that surface. All right, so the proper use of antiseptic wipes, the proper use of proper detergent that can kill up to, as they claim, 99.9999. So this will kill these agents if they live outside in the media. All right, so if it is in human or in the animal, you can use the antimicrobial. If they live on the surface, you can start the process of disinfection by using the appropriate material. All right, what about the second phase? The reservoir. Suppose the agent live in a reservoir, this how can you manage the proper treatment? Remember when we talk about the use of the antimicrobial, something important that has been highlighted by the World Health Organization, the WHO, what we call it, antimicrobial stewardship program. So what is the antimicrobial stewardship program? This way we're going to use the wise use of the antimicrobial to avoid the new release of resistant strain for the antimicrobial. So make sure that from now onward, never use antimicrobial unnecessarily, because what you are doing, you are helping to the development of resistant strain of these agents. All right, now we use those. What can else we can use as a barrier to work over those chain of infection? Use the proper hand hygiene technique. If you use the proper hand hygiene technique, so this means that if you come in contact with a contaminated surface, if you come in contact with an infected person, so the proper hand hygiene technique will help to kill as much as possible from those infectious agents. What else? Use properly the PPE, the personal protective equipment. So when it comes to a droplet infection or airborne infection, you can use properly either the face mask, the medical mask, the N95, the face shield. If you like to protect the eye, use the goggles, use the face shield. If you like, during a process of the sexual contact with known infected partner, so you can use properly a barrier like the condom. So if you are working in an area where it has a lot of infected people, like you are dealing with patients with hepatitis B, vaccination will be the proper technique to help yourself against receiving immunoglobulin, will be a kind of help. And finally, the avoiding sharp injury will be another way, another technique to avoid unnecessarily transmission of infection from infected person to a healthcare workers. So these are a kind of things that we have to focus on during the process of the prevention of infection, using the proper antimicrobial, properly use the personal protective equipment, hand hygiene is a must, immunization for the susceptible group and healthcare workers, immediate taking of the immunoglobulin if you got an infection, and remember the social distance will play an important part to prevent again one of these modes of the transmission. So this is all about the chain of infection.